have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. I'm Mike Mixtape, and... Oh, God.
Get this long... camera in the face. I didn't ask for this interview. Stop it.
What are you doing?
Stop.
I all right, son, fine, I'll stop. Jesus Christ. Christ. Calm down. God. Welcome to Cinema Royale, where we talk about movies bi-weekly. This discussion will be about a revisitation of a previous episode, which we talk about video game movies. But first, let me introduce to our film aficionados. First up, we have Anna Matt.
Hmm? Huh? What? What? Holy crap, I'm in the podcast. Oh god, I better get ready. Let's do this.
Close enough.
Then we got Morgan Liger.
I'm wearing a 3DS, so...
Hi, everyone. I just want to say very briefly, I'm starting a Kickstarter program for a feature film I'm working on. It will be a kid's movie with the greatness of an adult film, so that way people of old and young can enjoy it. It's called Debbie Does Minions.
I knew that was happening. I knew Debbie was going to come back.
And oh god, my sex video! Oh no!
And I hear that Oliver Stone is interested in it, seeing he's coming off of his latest sequel that's most anticipated, Turner and Hooch, Bulldogs Never Sleep.
This is the shit that you were getting mad that I was interrupting.
Debbie!
It's taking your nonsensical GR-rated movie so you could make a Minions joke. This is the kind of shit that I have to deal with.
Next up is James Sullivan.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by Bloopy TV, your all-in-one autism information station. For more information, check the link down below in the description box. Mike, I'll send you the link later. And also, happy birthday to me, Mario! It's been 30 years since I became on the scene! And what do you know, we have a podcast all about the video game movies, so let's start with Mario, God. Yeah!
That's true. I actually wore the right t-shirt then. Hold on.
Luigi, you got screwed. You had Luigi's Mansion when I bid better for him.
Nintendo World anniversary.
Say hi! Oh, who are you, Luigi? Say hi to Eddie Murphy for me. I'm gonna go be successful.
Then we have our... Sorry.
If we can get through the intro, that'll be
great.
Shut up, James. I'm gonna come down there and just bop you in the head.
I already lost everybody with Debbie Does Minions.
Hey, banana!
No, it's zip banana!
Okay. No. Next up we have Jada Gonzalez from... Gonzalez from up north in Canada. Say hello, Jada.
No, I'm sorry. I'm still mad about this, and I'm still going to sulk about this, because let me tell you something. When I hear that you're going to make a plan for a movie in a whole place full of people who keep making plans for shit that I don't understand, I don't know what freaking Let's Plays mean. I don't know what Animat even stands for, but I put up with it, and I put in the effort that I got to put in to make sure that you know what does and doesn't make sense. You and your Minions jokes. You know how many Minions jokes have been made in the past week? Too damn many! I don't need this!
By the way, I can pretty much say this now. Don't you sass over the second highest grossing animated feature of all time.
I'll sass all I fucking want. Minions are annoying. It's not the
thank
point.
Thank you!
Minions are obnoxious.
Mike, I'm thinking of putting in my 2 weeks notice.
Aww.
It's only 2 weeks, so...
Oh, well.
And lastly...
Our guest of the night is Daniel Swallows, also known as Sonic Guru.
Hello. Hi. I'm the only British person here.
Wait, you're British?
I'm British.
Yeah.
I thought you were faking it this whole time. I thought you were just trying to get with me. Fuck the accent. I put aside my plans for y'all. This is the way I get treated.
I can't help it. It happens.
I did not sign for this. I'm gonna go back watching Debbie Does Minions.
It's not my fault you got the wrong impression. I'm just who I am.
It's not even a good fake British accent. I don't know why I was told.
I don't have an accent.
Actually, like, hearing it now, it is, like, coming a bit off. You are starting to go Americanized.
My wife's from New York, okay?
Yeah,
spent
I know.
Spent 2 weeks here to get married. So, I think New York comes out, I blame her.
Oh, good God.
Oh, good.
So, I never even knew that Sarah was from New York. Jeez.
Right, so, let's get the ball rolling with, since James said it, let's start off with the Mario movie, not the live action, but the Japanese animated movie that came out in 1986.
All right. Yes, this one I believe is called The Great Mission to Rescue Princess Peach. If I got a word or so off there, I apologize, because for freak's sake, you don't need to make the title so darn long. And second, yes, I'd also like to say that this is the first time anyone decided to actually make a video game-based movie. And, well, aside from Tron, but,
I mean, that's the difference, really. There's video game-based and video game-related.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's based off of a video game. So, yeah. Here we have that first case, and boy... I showed it to Mike. I wanted to show it to Morgan.
Ugh.
But,
good lord, he had two options. There was the Japanese with English subtitles, and there was a fan dub. He was like, which one do you want to watch? Which one do you want to watch? I was like, alright, let's watch the Japanese with the English subtitles. That'd be good. We'll watch the original, not this fan dub. Ugh.
Yeah, well... I mean, I'd already started watching the fandom the night before, but if the Japanese dub is any indication, it wasn't really that good of a movie to begin with.
Exactly.
And that's the hard thing to say here, is that when you're making a movie, you need to focus on certain things like characters, story, development. These are all things that typically make a movie good. I say typically because we're probably going to be discussing a few exemptions to the rule here tonight. But we're going to, in a video game, at least in the beginning, character development and story, those things were not important at all. And that's why when you have a case such as this, where a movie's directly adapted from a video game source, it doesn't really work, because in the game you're just trying to get from point A to point B.
They're like it's a platformer, and it's a Mario platformer. There's basically a vague plot. There's no backstory to it. You just know that Princess is captured by a giant turtle ox monster. Go get her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because back then, like pre-95, it's like two video game stories that people actually wrote. It's either save the girlfriend or plot device or shoot the thing.
Okay. There you go. It does not an interesting movie make, unless you're making The Last Starfighter or something. But, in any case, yeah, this is the whole story here. Mario starts out, he's playing a video game late at night, he's binging. Like you do, and Princess Peach and Bowser come flying out of his TV. He immediately falls in love with her, but Bowser captures her and pulls her back in, and he's got to go after her.
Mm-hmm. So the thing is, they're not plumbers per se in this. They have a grocery store.
Mm-hmm.
Well, considering the amount of jobs Mario's had over the 30 years of his existence, grocery store owner, it does not surprise him.
Mamma mia, Luigi, it's that Mr. Eggplant Man!
It's not even a qualified doctor either, so...
I think it's official. He's not even a doctor. I think, like Miyamoto said, that he could be an entirely different Mario entirely.
And so, oh yeah, I also noticed something that could be considered a screw up, until Mike reminded me that in Japanese, in the Famicom game, Luigi's colors are actually yellow and blue. I did not know this going into the movie, so I'm just like, what's with yellow Luigi?
That is based on the original Mario Bros., I believe.
That could be, that's what I mean, yeah. Was the
in Super Mario Bros., he was just yellow and green.
Mm-hmm. That's what he is in this anime, basically, in that color. And Luigi here, he's money hungry. He's a greedy little bastard. He wants, because once they go to the Mushroom Kingdom, he wants to get all the gold, and he's like, gold, gold, gold!
Mm-hmm.
Wario, before Wario even existed.
Jeez.
Yeah. There's one scene in the film that sums it up. They're having this little montage going, walking across on their way to rescue Princess Peach from one world to another. That's the thing. This movie is a bunch of montages that just sort of pad the movie out. That does not make a movie. It's not even a movie. It's not even an hour long. But point being, they're just walking along, and there's a castle that comes up in the background.
Yep.
And Luigi runs off to the castle, beats the crap out of the castle, and you see all these coins flying out. The castle comes down, and he runs back and joins Mario in like 5 seconds, and I'm like, huh?
I think I just figured out where the hell I got those cutscenes from Mario World from.
Oh...
I just got the one where Mario jumps and just high kicks the castle. Like,
oh,
okay.
Yes.
Like,
yeah,
he
does, but see that.
Like...
And see, that works better in the game, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. So the thing we left out is that before they go in the Mushroom Kingdom, there was a dog that kind of comes up to them. It's like, let's go, let's go, let's go, and it leads them to the Mushroom Kingdom. Like, so there's a dog with them.
Mm-hmm.
Is it like the Duck Hunt dog? Or
nope.
Like...
Nope, it's this goofy-looking dog that's, like, blue, a blue dog with a... It's weird.
He's a caterpillar body.
Yeah, there you go.
Would you like to eat my candy bars?
It was... But later on in the film, the dog is revealed as something else. The big plot twist of the movie is the dog...
is actually the
spoiler
prince.
Spoiler alert, guys.
Spoiled it.
Got it on the first try.
Really?
No. The plot twist is the dog the whole time, after they broke the curse of everything in the Mushroom Kingdom, was another prince from the Flower Kingdom.
He got it right. Matt said prince.
Yeah. Oh. Mm-hmm. He is a prince.
God damn, I wasn't listening. Fuck.
It's Peach's real boyfriend.
Yeah.
Yes.
He comes out of nowhere, and Mario's like, aww.
And so the two of them married, and Mario and Luigi went back to their supermarket business until all their little toadstool workers went on strike and went bankrupt. The end.
Yes, that's exactly what happened.
Yep, exactly.
What?
You could... Now see, Morgan, you just came up with a better story. I'm sorry for those of you that have been shipping Mario and Peach for about 30 years thanks to the video games, but this is where your princess really is.
Is with a dog.
Mm-hmm. But that's not the most mind-blowing thing of all.
What's another one?
Well, actually, I'll start with the second most mind-blowing. Second most mind-blowing thing is... Koopa is played by a woman.
Woman?
A woman? So I looked it up, because mm-hmm. Bowser sounded like kind of like a nerdy, kind of wimpy kind of guy. Like,
I'm going to get you, Prince. I'm going to get you, Princess.
Wait, in the fan dub or the...
No, in the original cut, the Japanese voice sounded nerdy to us, and I looked it up to see if it was a male or female. It was a female. It's a Japanese woman voicing Bowser.
Mm-hmm.
It's and Big Bertha!
It's funny.
In defense, there actually are some villains in anime who can work when they actually have a female voice.
Yeah, that's what I hear.
Yeah,
This is not one of those cases.
No, it doesn't sound intimidating. It just sounds like a wimpy, wimpy little dork.
I'm gonna get you, princess. Come back here, princess, my sweet bamboo.
Yeah, that I remember in the movie, like when Bowser just has like this huge crush on Peach, and like she just resists him as much as she can. Like that's the weird thing.
Yeah, well, the question's still up. Who is Bowser Jr.'s mother?
We still don't know. We still don't
mind
know.
You, Miyamoto answered that. Miyamoto answered that.
Yeah. He knows. He knows.
Yeah, he just went... That's what he did.
Oh my gosh.
No word of a lie.
My secret is, I am a woman. And the number one most mind-blowing thing about this movie is the product placement.
Ah, yes.
There's product placement?
Yes, there's product placement in this movie. So, you see Mario eat, like, ramen. He put some sprinkles on it. They're Mario ramen, Mario sprinkles just to put on there.
Mm-hmm. There was an actual... This was an actual cross-promotion here.
It was.
Mario ramen noodles was a thing.
Yeah, because they had to promote the film somehow, so they did promote it via ramen and whatever else in Japan. So, kind of, it was like, we gotta put product placement in this movie, and then we sell it, promote it. It was just weird seeing them eating ramen. It was like, what?
Well, it's not the fact that it's ramen. It's the fact that it's Super Mario ramen.
Right, yeah, because it has his face on the box. So I was just like, what?
Just to clarify, would that be ramen or raw men?
Noodles.
Ramen. Noodles.
Are you implying a sexual term, Morgan? Because
Really? Hey, they're pronouncing it as raw men, alright?
Ramen? Who
pronounces it? Ramen.
Because, like... Because you're implying raw men, like
it's
something...
like we didn't say that slow. We just said
that
ramen.
Like a Magic Mike term.
Ramen.
Yeah, he just said it. He said ramen.
Is that the wrong pronunciation? I'm a Midwestern.
No. I thought that was ramen.
It's ramen.
That's ramen, which is the noodles, and ramune, which is a drink.
You know,
and then there's Romulan, which is an alien.
You know, in Canada we call them Mr. Noodle.
No, we still call them ramen. That's just a brand.
It's the brand that... It's like how we call corn dogs pogos. You know, they're still technically corn... You know, pogos, the brand.
Yeah, I know. But
brand associations, a thing.
But, like, Mr. Noodles are not that level of popularity.
They are here.
I've actually found the actual advertisement for Mario Ramen.
And the why that this is so mind-blowing is it makes no sense. I mean, if he was wearing Nike shoes or something, that would at least be sensible because, you know, okay, who doesn't wear a certain brand of shoes? But he's advertising his own product, and he shouldn't even know that this exists.
All right, so... There's one more thing we left out, and this is probably be the last thing we'll talk about, is that there's a thing called the Triforce they have to get in the film.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, Triforce?
That Triforce, would you like to know what it's made up of?
Three triangles.
It's made up of a mushroom, a flower, and a star. That is the Triforce here.
They actually call it the Triforce in the film.
That's how they incorporate the game elements. Yeah.
Oh, Mario and Zelda were developed at the same time, so.
Mm-hmm. Try to get their games confused. It's not a bad film. I mean, it was the first video game-based movie ever, but it gives effort to trying to incorporate everything into it.
Mm-hmm. And it, you know, despite, we've spoken before about the Super Mario Brothers movie with Bob Hoskins several times. At least that was, among all the liberties that movie takes, at the very least that you could say that was interesting. This movie is not. It's like, what if you made The Wizard of Oz without any TLC whatsoever?
Yeah. So, we're gonna jump way into the from the 80s till the aughts. So in 2006, there was like three video game movies released. There was Blood Rain, Silent Hill, and DOA. We're going to talk about two of those. And of course, everybody, James and Jada wanted DOA so bad. It's unbelievable. Oh. I was like,
because there's so much to talk about. It's like, okay, I'm not going to, like, actually share my opinion on the movie until we talk about it, because fair is fair, but...
So...
Yeah. Okay, who has this movie?
So, we'll...
I used to own it.
No, I mean, whose topic is the movie?
So, here's the thing. I have it on DVD. I claimed it before James and Jada did. And Jada had to go with Silent Hill as the last resort. I'm sorry for that, Jada, but...
on the bright side...
Blood Rain. Screw that.
Mm-hmm.
No.
That's Uwe. That's Uwe Boll. Exactly. What else do you expect?
That's not significant to any part of Hollywood's history.
Nope.
Well, I'm probably the only one who sat through it.
Ouch.
Ouch.
Why would you do that?
I sat through that.
Torture. Wow.
Ouch.
Oh, Blood Rain, Alone in the Dark 2, Postal, Far Cry.
I've yet to say why.
Because why the fuck not? It's like,
because Uwe Boll, he's the greatest director of all time.
Okay, I was like, here's a film, here's a notepad. How many ways can they fuck this up?
Yes.
So yes. Let's briefly discuss how much Silent Hill sucks.
Mm-hmm.
The game on the
movie.
The
movie.
The movie.
The movie.
I wouldn't be able to tell you much about the game. I haven't played it. The movie was just... yay.
The first movie, not its sequel, which is probably worse. It looked way worse. But...
Yeah. Yes, there was a big action scene with Pyramid Head. What? No.
Silent Hill came out in the 2000s, a few years after Resident Evil, and by the same company, so presumably to capitalize off of the attention that Resident Evil was getting by saying, hey, let's make some more horror-based only, you know, worse. So, Silent Hill is sort of, kind of, claims to be based off of the first, second, third, and fourth game combined. You know, so it's like elements of all four of them, in that it's its own continuity, because I guess making a direct adaptation of one of the games would seem pointless, which is kind of fair, I guess.
Yeah, because all four games have separate continuities.
Yeah.
In its own right, because of all based on the characters, but
which
how
is,
should...
Speaking of a movie which supposedly has the combined continuities in all of them, it's a little confusing, but the good news is you can't even tell, because it's really not done well at all. Mostly, it just is reminiscent of the first and second, in, you know, the story style and stuff. But anyway, it follows a woman named Rose and her adopted daughter named Sharon. One day, Sharon has, like, this hissy fit while sleepwalking and starts screaming obnoxiously, Silent Hill! So, Rose, after this, decides, I guess she wants to go to this place called Silent Hill. Let's just go there, because why the fuck not, am I right? What could possibly go wrong? Did you get that? Oh, God, no.
Yeah, we got it.
I got it all.
You're good.
Sometimes everything works when it wants to. Anyway, they get the Silent Hill. When they get there, Rose, like, crashes the car, and it's knocked out. And when she wakes up, oh no, her daughter Sharon's missing. So the rest of the game plays out similarly to the first game, that she goes around the town searching for her missing daughter, and during which time she finds all this creepy stuff, and eventually she stumbles across this weird demon cult thing and finds out that Sharon apparently has this big connection to all these demon supporting people and stuff, and everything about the town and this creepy stuff can be explained by this cult, which some people have generously described as pretty weak. So, Silent Hill. It's not a very good movie. I get the idea of wanting to make a movie of Silent Hill. It's very story-based. It's very cinematic in its feel. It's not your typical video game style in its gameplay. But they just don't get the right idea about it, because they think they could just make it your typical, like, horror story.
Although, can I ask, for anybody who does play, who has seen the movie Silent Hill, I would like to ask, which is worse, the Silent Hill movie, or the decision to cancel PT?
Decision to cancel PT.
Ah, okay.
Hands down.
Yeah, admittedly, that does sound terrible.
What are those, may I ask?
PT is called, the short for playable teaser, was a Silent Hills demo-ish of where you just travel on the same hallway over and over and spooks happen. It was on the Fox engine, being directed by Hideo Kojima and being produced and written by
Guillermo del Toro.
That's the one. I can never pronounce his name. And it was going to star Norman Reedus, who is Daryl in The Walking Dead. It was a big fucking thing. And Konami, being Konami, in a case, fuck Konami, decided to cancel it. And instead released a Silent Hill-themed pachinko machine. So. But,
to add to that, Guillermo del Toro actually lost faith in making video games because of it.
Because this game and his last game, Insane, were both cancelled.
So Konami essentially pulled a Microsoft, is what you're trying to tell me here.
Oh, Microsoft.
That's how they're running their business lately.
But getting back to Silent Hill, I think the only reason why Silent Hill the movie does not in any way come as high as the games is the atmosphere and the writing.
It doesn't...
Because when you're playing Silent Hill, you're making the decisions. You're wandering through this town. Whereas in the film, it's like, don't walk through that door, you stupid bitch. There you go, the pyramid head.
How many different horror cliches can we chalk off here?
Go.
You are quiet, Yada.
Sorry, I had to turn the mic off briefly because of background noises. Anyway, I'm a fan of the Silent Hill games, some of them anyway, the main concept of them and their, like, world. One of the things I really like about them is that they have this interesting, as Daniel said, sort of atmospheric sense of horror, in that they, like, they get psychological about it, you know? They get in your head. They specifically try to get to know the gamer so that they can fuck with your perception of reality. And it's a unique kind of experience that you don't see very often, and it's incredibly hard to do in movies. You need to be like a Kubrick style genius in order to pull that kind of, like, audience confusing bullshit off, you know what I mean?
Gil Toro could possibly pull it off, though.
Oh yeah.
Silent Hill the movie doesn't, for bloody hell's sake, Morgan.
We already have that. It's called The Shining.
There's a few movies that you can say pull it off, but, you know, for a Silent Hill adaptation to really work, it would need to be made by someone who could pull that off. The good news is, the Silent Hill movie doesn't actually even try to do this. They opt instead to go all traditional horror type with it and make the creepy stuff mostly a demon cult, because demon cults are super cliched, so we can do that easily. And it just,
completely forgetting that the fact that the main evil of the series is the town itself.
They completely turn into a generic mess, and it just takes away. There's none of that cryptic psychological feel that made Silent Hill movies recognizable. This could be a horror movie about anything. You could have attached another name to it, and barely anybody would have been able to tell, unless you obviously crap out the two pyramid head scenes that were clearly so important.
Yeah, because the pyramid head from Silent Hill 2 representation of the evil in James Sunderland. He wasn't the mascot.
It just takes the predictable route with all the story decisions, and nothing feels relatable, and so you feel totally disconnected and not remotely like you're watching the type of thing that could be considered video game horror quality. And also, the CGI is terrible.
Also, like, the first time watching it, I was kind of scared and a bit disturbed. But looking back on it, it's like, what was I scared about?
There were a few gory scenes, so if you like gory scenes, then, you know, watch Saw. But,
yeah, I watched Saw, like...
Huh.
Sorry, it's just, you know, it's if it's used in a clever way, much like jump scares, if it's used in a certain clever way that's, like, helpful to the tone that you're going for, then you can make it scary. If you just, like, throw it in there willy-nilly and expect it to be scary on its own, it's not gonna happen. It's just not how it happens. Audiences are smarter than that.
Right, and mind you, Silent Hill was a Canadian-French production. There's no Americans involved with it. So
doesn't make it right.
I mean, they're...
Wait. Oh, no, wait. It's more in Jada's neck of the woods, because this was apparently filmed in Brantford. Or... Well, is that Brantford or Hamilton?
Brantford, Ontario.
In Ontario.
I'm looking at the page right now. It says Brantford, Ontario.
Ontario's a big fucking province, okay?
It's still Canada! What you...
Hey, you live in New York. You've seen the Statue of Liberty, right? That's how that works. Location's small.
We need someone to blame, so... When I heard French-Canadian, I was like, oh no, it's not my fault, it's not my fault, it's not my fault. Yeah, it's not filmed in Montreal.
Yeah. We kids are you afraid of the dark for Nickelodeon, so you guys have to be grateful that we even decided to pursue horror in the first place. Otherwise, y'all would just be stuck with fucking Goosebumps.
Well, we can say this without a doubt. The Silent Hill movie is much better than Silent Hill Revelation.
Pop tart jump scare.
So, one of the main features we're going to talk about is a film called DOA Dead or Alive. And, because, like I said, James and Jada wanted to talk about it so bad because I had it on DVD, so there's a lot to talk about when it comes to this film. And we try to be brief about it as much as we can. And, I did watch the film with James and Daniel here, and it was interesting. I've seen it before, but it was just girls fighting and all that jazz.
Yes, it's... It is Charlie's Angels meets...
And that's the extent of the game.
Exactly.
No, the extent of the game is just two things. Fighting and boobs. That's pretty much it.
That's what I said. It's just girls in bikinis fighting each other.
With some volleyball
it.
In the mix.
Maybe occasionally...
Don't forget the jiggling engine.
Mm-hmm.
Jiggle physics.
You ready for me to break the ice? Because I have a full disclosure for you. Eons ago, when I bought this movie on a whim because it was very cheap at Movie Stop, I put it on. I was doing some work on my laptop, and I figured, it might be one of those movies where I just tune in once in a while and I look up at my screen. And once I'm done with my work, I'll just sort of remember something about the movie. So I put it on, worked on an essay or a video or something, and sure enough, about an hour and a half later, I look up, I see the end credits are rolling, and I say to myself, wow, boring movie.
Wow, I remember nothing at all.
Wow, I guess I have no soul.
I guess
after
I didn't hear all the action going on in the background.
I guess I didn't see Jamie Presley in a bikini with the American flag on it.
I didn't see hot girls fighting. I didn't see boobs bouncing around or anything like that. But yeah,
Really? American flag bikini? Yeah. Okay. Ah, to that.
It's silly, but it's silly in a fun way. Why don't you
It's not sexy. The last thing I need is the Confederate flag bikini. Come on.
Flag
bikinis are so cliche.
Okay, nobody is wearing a Confederate flag bikini. Okay? That would be pretty ridiculous, I think. Especially for Japanese video games.
Poor game, keep in mind, like...
All I'm just saying is, it's not interesting to me.
Maybe not. Okay. Maybe not the American flag, but I would definitely go with a girl with two giant maple leaves, just saying.
And for information, Morgan, the Confederate flag bikini does exist.
Mike, do you want to start, like, describing the plot?
Basically, in a nutshell...
I got dishes.
I'd like to go with the plot.
Go with the plot for $200 here. So, basically, in a nutshell, you have these group of girls who get invited to this fighting tournament. They go to this island. They have to... And the prize money is, like... What was it? 100,000?
X amount of dollars.
X amount of dollars.
I think 100
it
million.
It could be like something like that. It's a grand prize for winning the tournament, dead or alive.
$1 million!
So, these group of girls have to, you know, fight in the tournament, and you have Eric Roberts as the bad guy in this film. Oh my god, Eric Roberts. He is the best. I love Eric Roberts as an actor. He does... Some good projects, some bad, but God, he's so cheesy as a good bad guy. He always plays bad guys, if you notice, in his films.
The Master in the Doctor Who movie? That was pretty bad.
Yes!
I don't give a shit what anybody says. I thought he was, like, the best part of that movie. That's right. I said it. I'm not taking it back. Nope.
Okay.
You weren't into the American flag bikinis? Okay.
So, alright, but here's the thing about this film. Basically, there's fighting, there's volleyball, there's some kind of shoestring.
There's volleyball!
There's a brief scene where they do volleyball, and they actually have the balls to be accurate to the games, and they play a little bit of volleyball in the game.
Oh my god, they put an element of DOA Extreme
yes,
in there.
Yes,
really?
They did. It's a brief little scene, but everything else is like fighting and they do all that.
With plot.
Thin. But there's like a thin plot where Kasume, I think her name is, has this thin plot where her brother is missing and she has to go.
Katsumi.
Yeah, thanks. Katsumi. She tries to find her brother who's been missing. And so the Shia goes on this tournament just to find him, and they end up finding him later on in the film. But the thing that flabbergasted me, because of course he was in the game, or in that universe somehow, was Ninja Gaiden. God, I was like, was like, he's in the game franchise, and he's in this movie too. As a,
oh, yeah, that
I was
is
like,
true.
What is he doing in this film? He doesn't...
Ninja Gaiden and Dead or Alive share the same universe.
It was weird. Like, why would they have the same shared universe? And of course, they put him in the movie.
Japan.
And it's called Hayabusa. No, his name is Ryu.
Yes, Ryu.
Ryu Hayabusa.
I thought it was just weird, just seeing that. But basically, Eric Roberts' big plan was to incorporate all these fighting elements, you know, because they get inserted with these like nanobots to record every moves they make and the timing and how they get into the fights. It was kind of interesting how they incorporate that into it. You know, you see on the screen where it's the life bar on top and all that stuff. And at the end, he has these special glasses he puts on, and the thing absorbs all the powers that all the fighters like recorded. And I was like, what the fuck is this? And the glasses predict all the moves that the opponent's gonna, like, make as, like, a hypothetical, like, replay. And then, as he's getting all the moves down, it's like, alright, I'm gonna block, block, block. And it was just like, what kind of... It's evil sunglasses. It's like, who comes up with this shit?
I think that's a brilliant idea, actually, but the thing is, they're trying to sell this thing to weapons manufacturers whatnot, and these guys have, missiles and guns and all this stuff, fighting techniques? I mean, what do you think is going to win out there?
Also, why does this guy need to have this big evil plan to sell this thing to all these people if he's clearly very rich already? Like, he's able to, like, host these giant fighting tournaments with, like, planes and boats and volleyballs and giant beaches and holograms.
Do you know where I think he gets most of his money from?
Merchandising.
Everything has DOA planes, DOA parachutes, DOA fighting posts, DOA nunchucks. Just DOA
everything. Take a drink every time you see that.
DOA plushies.
Point number three, did he really need to make this an evil plan? Like, what if he just told the fighting people the truth, gave them some money, and had them do fighting that he could download? Then it would all be legal, and there wouldn't be a conflict. Why did he have to be sneaky about it? Just because he's Eric Roberts and he has to be the bad guy?
Of course.
It don't make sense. Because
they have a nerdy guy in there who invented the glass. I'm like, I'm Wespy. I'm the dork. I love, Cart.
His name is Weatherby.
Weatherby. I'm Weatherby. I'm the dork of the crew. I invent everything, and it's just like... He has a crush on one of the fighters, and they end up together.
Alina.
Yes, thank you. And it's just... Why is he in... He was...
I want to talk to you guys about something in regards to...
Yes.
This. It's a very important subject that I haven't touched upon yet in this podcast. It's called The Eternal Struggle of the Bisexual Feminist. Or the Lesbian Feminist, in some cases. Lord knows, this doesn't just happen to me. But let me tell you something. When there's a move that comes out that objectifies the shit out of women, some people feel a certain way about it, like, hey, it's a bunch of women in bikinis, how can you go wrong? It's a fun time, we love women in bikinis, am I right? Sexy ladies, am I right, guys? And then there's other people who look at it from the other way, like, hey, why is there just a bunch of women in bikinis who don't really have, like, reasons to wear them, they're just being objectified all over the place. Women aren't objects, it's sexist as shit. What the fuck, Hollywood? Then there are some people that are cursed with both. I am one of those people. And let me tell you something about how I deal with it. I find that Daniel is giving me something of a look right now. What's up, Daniel?
No, I'm just waiting for your response. I was just scratching my nose.
Okay, look. You compared this to Charlie's Angels earlier. Who was it that James? I hated Charlie's Angels.
Yeah.
I hated the sequel even more. But first, I hated the first movie. The movie, mind you.
Those were fun movies.
Sequel sucked.
Well, at least the first one was fun.
Yeah.
Now,
Bill Murray.
Dumb, but fun.
I hated the Charlie's Angels movies. I love Dead or Alive. I'm sorry, I do. I can't help it. I can, like, tell myself that I shouldn't, but it's not going to change anything. The love just stays there. So why do I love this movie but hate Charlie's Angels? There's a few reasons. One, there's the matter of being an adaptation. Charlie's Angels, the show, was actually quite revolutionary in certain ways because it had, like, women fighting crime and speaking up for themselves. They certainly had more agency and more personality and more independence and were, believe it or not, fetishized just a little bit less in the 70s than they were in the original movies. So in that sense, I felt that the movies really lost what made the show great other than sexy ladies fighting crime, which was, I guess, the only thing they saw. Dead or Alive, on the other hand, if you play the video games, the movie is essentially exactly like the video games. Like, I have to give them
exactly.
A game franchise. Like, they knew what they were adapting, and they adapted to the letter. I can't say that about Silent Fucking Hill.
Oh,
it's a good...
Although I will say DOA kind of falls in the same plot as the Super Mario Bros. Movie, where there's not much plot, so they make one up. But even then,
and the plot
DOA actually had an excuse saying, "Oh, it's a safe fighting tournament," rather than just, "Oh, hey, let's do Charlie's Angels, but with more bikinis."
Because people
and DOA plot doesn't make any sense, but it doesn't really matter because you don't watch DOA plot. You watch it for the adventure.
Mm-hmm. You watch it for the action.
Another thing is DOA was just flat out better at being sexy. Like, I love Lucy Liu, but I'm sorry, the freaking leaderhood thing and the plot thing, they didn't really know what they were doing.
Yeah, there's a difference between adaptations with different media, so DOA did, you know, it was a crazy concept, you know, girls fighting bikinis, boobies jiggling, and the transition to movie was just fantastic. I mean, that's what it is, exactly. It's not a bad adaptation, it's a good adaptation of the film, of the game.
Although, if I may add to it, there's just, honestly, the fact that there is, I'm sorry to say this, but, like, the fact that there is an adaptation to Dead or Alive, it kind of bothers me, honestly. I feel like it just doesn't make sense in general to make one. Because, here's the thing. Number one. There were two explanations. I knew one of them, but there was another explanation I was thinking of, but suddenly I just lost it for some reason. But anyways, I'll get back to it. But number one about Dead or Alive is that, let's be honest here, anybody who ever plays, like, Dead or Alive, who really plays it for the story aspect?
Like, that's what we were nobody. Just saying, like, didn't have a plot, so they had to make up a plot, and the plot didn't make sense, but the plot didn't really matter. It was just a means to get it
nobody,
into...
Like, yeah. As an example, at the end of Kasumi's arcade mode, in Dead or Alive 4, I believe, her ending cutscene is that she's a mermaid.
What?
Now that should have been kept.
Yeah, it should have.
Would have been amazing.
What?
Kasumi is a mermaid and she's lip syncing to a song that's playing over. It is 100% what the fuckery.
It's amazing.
King Triton. Wow. King Triton, be not pleased.
Yeah.
Oh, are you fighting with those girls again?
I'm actually going to sort of draw the line there in terms of what should it have made to the film.
And another thing I'll say about the DOA is at least the plot is a lot more coherent and understandable, yet stupid, than King of Fighters.
Actually, there is another point I just realized. Oh,
I'm still in the middle of, like, my point.
Go.
Say your piece.
To bring up and differentiates Dead or Alive from other exploitive action female movies like Charlie's Angels is that Dead or Alive actually had likable characters in it. Not interesting per se, not really in depth, but they were, like, all colorful and different from one another, and I could at least sort of be entertained by what they were doing. Like, you had Kasumi and her, like, weird Japanese sumo thing going on that was nothing representing any kind of actual sumo royal thing at all. She's a ninja samurai princess, which is ridiculous. But it's at least, you know, that's a character, all right. And then you have Jamie Presley, who's essentially playing Jamie Presley, which is excellent, because real talk, I have the biggest crush on Jamie Presley, you guys. Like, seriously, for real. I'd watch anything that woman was in. She's excellent.
Which one is she? Tina?
Yeah. She's Tina. She's Tina. She was the wrestler.
Okay. Just make this.
She's the American woman. Wonderful. You got an American professional wrestler, and you got a friggin' Australian assassin chick. And then you got the other sumo samurai woman who's not a princess. Maybe she is, because maybe she marries the princess's brother. I don't know what happens in her life. Basically,
Anyane.
They're all fun, colorful backgrounds. And not all of them are acted very well, per se. But they are, like, original. They're unique. They're creative. I can respect certain Charlie's Angels was all like generic, predictable stuff. Like you could have made a checklist for it. You got a ninja massaging scene, check. You got sexy lederhosen, check. You know, it was just all there, and it was pretty predictable. With Dead or Alive, who the fuck knew what was going to happen? It was all so out there.
Even though it hit the trope. Even though it hit the,
everybody has
it hit the trope, though, with, like, shower scene.
I guess what I'm trying to say is Charlie's Angels pretty much sucked because it was incredibly objectifying and didn't really have much else to offer. Dead or Alive is also quite objectifying, and I can't... Do I approve of it? No. Do I enjoy the fuck out of it? I have to say yes, because, you know, we are what we are. We all have our flaws, don't we?
Okay. Good. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Next one.
All right, next one. We're going to another animated film. Professor Layton.
Yes. Just want to know, anybody here played the Professor Layton games? Or Dan? Good.
Not a clue. Good.
Okay, anyways, I just want to mention right now that, honestly, at least from what I've seen, Professor Layton is probably the best movie that's based on a video game, and it really does help considering that it is from the people that also made the games. Professor Layton and the Eternal Diva, basically, the story is pretty much a detective movie where Professor Layton goes to this opera show, and it turns out to be, like, this boat. So, throughout this whole time, Professor Layton has to solve the mystery of what's going to be going on while they're pretty much playing this game of, like, who can actually get the mythical, like, this mythical, like, what was it, gauntlet or something? It was, like, this magical potion that would give them eternal life. But, like, as the mystery unfolds, there's a lot more to it. Now, what really makes it really amazing, and now that I've played some of the Professor Layton games, thank you, Luna, thank you, Riku, is that, like, you can really, it really shows that it's so faithful to the games. It is ridiculous. The thing is with the Professor Layton games is that it's a puzzle, because it's a puzzle-based game. Like, there is, like, a story, a mystery that you gotta go solve, but at the same time, there are, like, you gotta go and solve puzzles. Even with that, they knew very well how to adapt those stories, like, adapt those elements into the whole movie. It's really interesting, considering that, like, the one who is organizing this whole, like, the whole mystery thing, like, he put in, like, some puzzles for everyone to solve, including Professor Layton. Also, I will mention that the animation is definitely fantastic, and plus the fact that what's interesting is that they also use the British cast instead of the American cast in the video games, and honestly, the British cast is much more better. It does have a bit more of the authenticity. But interestingly enough, the only person that they kept in there was actually Professor Layton. That's pretty much the same voice throughout the entire game. Like, he's also the voice in the movie, and it's just everything about it is just amazing. And as the mystery unfolds, without spoiling anything, I gotta say, holy crap, does it get, like, it gets even more action-packed, it gets more epic, it also gets freaking emotional when you learn about the motives and why, like, the mystery person is doing all this. It just really gets emotional. And it is interesting to note also that it is kind of, like, set in the beginning. They say it's
The game takes place between The Last Spectre and The Miracle Mask.
Yeah, okay, yeah, there we go.
After the first of the second trilogy.
Mm-hmm. And actually, one of the most interesting factors that I want to mention is how it actually opened it. Like, this is honestly the best way to introduce, like a video game movie for anyone, because it actually legit starts out saying what Professor Layton is, honestly. Like, they actually just say it starts as a game. It sold millions of hits. It's really popular in Japan and in several other countries and stuff like that. While they actually show you previous, they pretty much show you flashbacks of what happened in the game. It really is interesting, and
Like, it's kind of surprising how there's no other movie that does that. Like, they legit tell you what it is. So I definitely recommend this for both, like, fans of the games and also non-fans. Like, if you want to get introduced to Professor Layton, go ahead and check the movie out, because that's basically what you're going to get with the games.
Yeah, I can't.
I got to say, if you go play the game, start with the first one, The Curious Village. That is very, that is the entry level. The rest, it is, just continue the stories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't played the games, but after watching a review of the of the movie, I kind of thought it looked interesting.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I mean, let's face it. I told Matt this weekend that apparently one of his videos talked my mother into watching more Studio Ghibli, so.
Hey, if it works, it works.
Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts on Professor Layton?
I got nothing else.
I owned it, but I never got around to watching it.
Okay.
You own it? Oh, I own it.
Owned it. I had an extensive collection of video game movies. I kind of had it in my head, like, I should get every single one of them. But when I couldn't find Blood Brain 3, I was like, you know what, fuck it. I couldn't find Blood Brain 3, I couldn't find King of Fighters, so I thought, fuck it.
You know, the funny thing is that I actually have the entire collection of Professor Layton, like, all the games, and I even got, like, some bonus stuff, like, I got a Professor Layton Rubik's Cube. The only thing that I don't have is a Blu-ray or a DVD of Professor Layton and the Eternal Diva. I would love to have that.
You have the spin-offs as well, Layton versus Phoenix Wright.
Yes, I even got Layton versus Ace Attorney, Phoenix Wright. Yeah.
Question, Dan, did you have Glovarella?
What?
Okay, Glovarella is not a movie. Video game movie, so I think.
No, that's a Uber. That has nothing to do with the subject, James.
Okay, never mind. Dork. Never mind.
That's probably that's an in joke I'm not aware of.
It's not in joke. It's not in joke. Same person. Blubberella. Blubberella.
So I was playing Professor Layton the Curious Village, and as far as the puzzles go in that game, actually are really big brain teasers.
Oh yeah, major.
And they're not simple.
No, some of them, like, they seriously gotta make you think. And I gotta say, like, my only criticism about the Professor Layton games is that it's kind of, it's uncomfortably weird how everybody in the village is so freaking obsessed with puzzles. It's like, hey, excuse me, you mind waiting there for a second? I got this puzzle here, you mind doing it for a moment? Like, I understand when, like, Layton tells Luke, like, oh, it's like, hey, I got a puzzle for you, you know, like, those little things, but, like,
At least in the Curious Village, it's explained that the mayor or one of the wealthiest people was obsessed with puzzles and left a series of puzzles
for his treasure.
Hey man, it's no more weird than, hey, you looked at me the wrong way. I demand you fight my Pokemon.
Mm-hmm.
You're the champion who got a level 99 Mewtwo.
Nope, I'm gonna challenge you. I got a level 5 Magikarp. Let's do this.
Well, some people, like, they not only do they want to battle, they want to tell us that their shorts are comfy.
So,
and I should make a Pokemon. That should be a Pokemon, but that's a pig with a flower on it.
Yes.
So,
which actually does exist now.
So yeah. Let's.
Damn fifth generations.
So let's go on to the next film, which is from Disney. Lucky enough, Prince of Persia.
Yeah. The Sands of Time.
Oh dear.
I actually am quite a big fan of the Prince of Persia series. More so the Ubisoft era than it was to the classic era. Even though I did own John and Mechner's original on the Game Gear. But the Prince of Persia movie, Sands of Time, based on the Sands of Time by Ubisoft. And it takes several liberties with it. First of all, it incorporates bits of Warrior Within and the Two Thrones, specifically the armor. Secondly, the prince has a name, Prince Dastan. He was never called anything in the games, even in the The Forgotten Sands, of which this film was supposed to be tying for, wasn't called Dastan. Well, the overall plot is by wants to get sent with an army to take out this kingdom or such for these weapons. Turn out there isn't, but they do it anyway. Jenny gets a framed for murdering his father, and he's hunted down by his brothers and Ben Kingsley.
Ben Kingsley.
Ben Kingsley, why you do this? Why you accept these roles?
Well, why would you rather have Ben Kingsley
first
as
blood rain
Ben
and now
Kingsley
this
as Nizam, or does this get?
Hey man, I've never seen Ben Kingsley phone in a row.
The Hood.
I have.
From the birds, the Hood. That's all I have to say.
Look, if he was in The Love Guru, he'll say yes to pretty much anything. Let's be real here.
So would John Goodman.
Hey, John Goodman, really good.
I love John Goodman. I've been watching episodes of Roseanne with Sarah.
Aww. Oh, did you get the episode where he does the table flip?
Not yet.
Did you get to the episode where Roseanne spanks her child and then regrets it?
No, watch the episode.
Sounds hilarious, though.
What about the weed episode where they find a bunch of pot and they smoke it, and like their friend is in the bathtub freaking out with a Jell-O pudding pop?
Are you sure this wasn't the Cosby Show?
No, it's hilarious. She's sitting there wide-eyed and just trying to eat a popsicle. It's hilarious.
Hey, I was stoned once. It's not a good experience, okay?
Tell me about it.
I felt like I was in a dream, okay? It wasn't a good experience. I was freaking out. But eventually, I'm trying to remember exactly. I have the movies and events. She gets the dagger. It's the dagger of time. So he realizes, oh, his sand's in it. The princess is all, why are you doing this? And Nizam's plot to find the hourglass, the sands of time. Which is completely different to what it is in game.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, it's just like there's a trekking back and talk about time travel and philosophy to understand. Oh, Nizam actually framed Dastan to kill his father. There's a bunch of assassins which look exactly like the assassins from Two Thrones. Kind of like, someone has the chain blade. The best comparison I can think of is the weapon Ivy uses in Soul Calibur.
Mmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that where they got the idea, or?
I don't know. Eventually, he gets to the center of town when his arm travels all the way back in time to stop the invasion. And it's like, yeah, Nizam. Like, Nizam, you're an asshole. I'm gonna kill you. Eventually, there's complete rewrite time, but he still has his memory. And eventually, you know what? For his peace, you, Dastan, should marry this princess who isn't. It's called Princess Tamina, I believe. Tamina. And instead of Princess Farah, which was she was in the center of time. Also, the original Sands of Time game had great story, great architecture, great game mechanics, although the combat really sucked. It wasn't improved until while we were in, but then again, everyone beat with the Axie Stick, and everyone was very emo. And the screaming emo rock. But as far as the screenplay goes, it actually was written by Jordan Mechner. Which surprised me, who actually was involved in the production.
The game writer?
The actual creator of Prince of Persia helped with the screenplay of Sands of Time.
That's good. Good.
There's a lot of differences between the Sands of Time game and Sands of Time movie, as it's trying to incorporate two other games as well as its classic variation. Like a prince having brothers murdering with framed for his father. But meeting the prince, trying to kill the vizier, or Nizam, following up with the princess, but then traveling back in time again to a specific point to retell his story, saying people think time is like a river or something. That's all I know about his speech at the end of Two Thrones. But other than that, it's confusing, and as a fan of the first game, it is kind of annoying that several liberties were taken. But the overall main plot, try and get the sands back and stop the vizier, is still intact. And out of everything, it is the highest grossing video game movie to date. Yes. Looking at it, a budget of $200 million, it made $336.4 million.
Eat that, Paul W.S. Anderson.
Would that be considered a hit? Like Disney, did Disney made his money back with it?
They made it money back. Yeah,
it's a hit for the video game,
I guess.
It failed domestic box office, but it became the highest grossing.
Not much of a hit for Disney standards.
Yeah, that's
all Jerry Bruckheimer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, because like with Prince of Persia and all those films, I feel like it's just one of those awkward films for Disney and Jerry Bruckheimer when they were trying to make more, like they want to try to make lightning strike twice with Pirates of the Caribbean. Like after that, like when they were trying to think of another movie to do, they were just pretty much all over the place and didn't really know what to do. They failed with The Sorcerer's Apprentice. It didn't really work out with Prince of Persia. And then they tried The Lone Ranger, which really was the camel that broke the straw. No, that broke...
The camel that broke the straw's back.
You fucked up the whole metaphor!
There you go. And that was the thing, because, that whole movie just... Like all those movies, they pretty much feel like they were just trying to make another Pirates in the Caribbean. So
they made another Pirates of the Caribbean.
Pretty much, exactly. So, they pretty much try to make a Fantasia Pirates in the Caribbean, and then they tried an Arabic Pirates in the Caribbean, and then they try to make a Cowboy Pirates in the Caribbean, none of which worked. The only one that did work was Pirates in the Caribbean.
And they made one in the future called Tomorrowland.
That one is not Jerry Bruckheimer.
As far as a video game movie, it's not a 100% adaptation.
Mm-hmm.
It's well acted. The story's understandable. You know, it involves time travel, which a lot of people don't understand. And seeing it being written by a different perspective, rather than just like, oh hey, it's exactly like this. The prince is called Prince because shut up.
Yeah, I guess I saw the movie and I thought it was all right, but it was kind of forgettable. My Prince of Persia generation was the original Macintosh game with the guy in the dungeon.
The cinematic platformer, which actually had two sequels. Prince of Persia 3D was the worst. The video game Forgotten Sands isn't that bad. Even though the Wii version is completely different.
So many technical difficulties with James here. Well.
James is frozen on the confused face.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, God. Time does go by really fucking fast.
Yep. Do we have time? Did we go through all of them?
There's one more.
Everybody forgets about poor Morgan. I ain't forgotten you, Morgan. You're good.
Thank you.
Well, here's this clue.
You're Mario!
No.
No.
No. No. No. That's
the timer. So.
Oh.
That's the timer.
You got 8 minutes!
Wait!
I told you it would fast!
Side to side. It's time to go do the Mario.
Quick, stop! The video game movie, what is it?
A
I'll tell you what it is.
Oh, God.
Nothing! Absolutely nothing! Don't judge! You're so stupid!
Yes!
I was gonna do a Phil Donahue stylized editorial rant as to why I didn't pick a video game movie. So I'll make a long story short. Because there's no one true video game movie out there that says to me, "Ooh, this is a great video game movie! Every other video game movie should be like this!" No! It was so many options, so many possibilities. They could take the narrative of a video game. They could take elements of the video game and adapt into something crazy and wild like Mortal Kombat or Super Mario Brothers. But no! We don't have that distinction yet. We're still catching up in that age where it's all like, oh, we are capitalizing on certain things and seeing how they're doing. The only way a video game movie works if it's A, the last Starfighter they incorporate into the plot with it being an audition to go off and fight aliens in a Battlestar Galactica kind of thing, or B, a commentary on the evolution of technology like Tron, the fact that there's a whole world that's based around in this video game and they do like gladiator kind of video games and stuff, or three, the product placement kind being the wizard, which completely fails because it's 2-in-1. A sweet, heartening, very awkward family movie, and a giant product placement film about nothing about Nintendo. There has yet to be a film that comes across me to say, wow, this is what a video game movie should be. This is what it should do.
Save us, Steven Spielberg.
I
just want to add to that. You're missing out point four to that, which is Indie Game the Movie, which was a documentary. That was actually pretty good up until mm-hmm. Phil Fish opened his fucking mouth on Twitter.
Yes, that's the thing.
And two, are you telling me you haven't watched Final Fantasy Spirits, Final Fantasy VII, The Spirit Advent Children?
Final Fantasy Spirits Within is not even connected to the video game.
Not Spirits Within, Advent Children. Final Fantasy VII, no. Advent Children.
I don't follow that franchise.
Okay, but Morgan, you know you didn't have to like the movie in order to talk about it, right? Like, we were also talking about the lows of video game movie dump, like with friggin' Silent Hill and weird Japanese Mario Brothers. That's what we did with part one. Or what you
but
did.
I guess what Morgan is trying to say is that there's none that interests him.
I think what Morgan's trying to say is be in the episode last week, so he just didn't
Morgan,
come up with video game
if you like, Morgan, if you like, I'm offering this. I'll send you Professor Layton and the Eternal Diva. You don't have to play the games to fully understand. Like, I didn't even play Curious Village before seeing Professor Layton, and I loved it. So I can offer you that.
Pass.
You sure? Okay.
You could watch GoldenEye. That's like a video game-based movie, only backwards.
I've seen GoldenEye. I don't even like James Bond.
You're not supposed to take my
pictures, Alexander!
No.
Give me the quotes, Natalia!
Oh, my God. I think we're all better off watching all the cutscenes of a video game. Like,
hey.
Metal Gear Solid 4.
Excuse me, GoldenEye is the best James Bond movie, so don't even play with me. Don't even play with me!
I'm not denying that. I even sat down and played the entirety of GoldenEye 007 on the Wii, the remake with Daniel Craig, and they bastardized the narrative on that.
How do you do GoldenEye with Daniel Craig? That doesn't make sense. It's a Pierce Brosnan movie.
Watch the Let's Play of it. You'll see every single difference they had. Well, again, like what? I said, if you want a video game movie, watch the cutscenes of any video game. I would suggest a Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater.
Okay. GoldenEye was revolutionary in the video game industry because it introduced the idea of multiplayer where you could do a live stream thing and have people play with each other in different locations. You know, like Xbox Live.
Then Halo came out and said, do you know what? We can do LAN and regenerating health. Then Call of Duty Modern Warfare came out and was like, oh, hey, we can do Modern Warfare stuff.
I didn't say
and now. I know what you're saying. Me and Mike played it quite. Me and my friend Mike played it quite a lot. Not this Mike, another Mike. I know GoldenEye. even in the film GoldenEye. Just, I think GoldenEye right now is being a bit overrated.
Okay,
but, hey,
I agree.
It's better than the fucking remake, okay?
Wow.
Because that was just Call of Duty with James Bond, that was.
I guess they thought that since Daniel Craig remade Casino Royale so well, they might as well just do that with every fucking James Bond movie.
Wait, they stick him in Goldfinger.
Oh, wait until you see 007 Legend, because wow. Let's take important scenes and moments of, like, five different James Bond movies and we'll place it all with Daniel Craig and put them all together in a different narrative.
Everybody,
that doesn't sound
everybody
good.
Everybody chill out yet? Everybody good?
Oh, I can go
I
on
bet
for
you
hours,
could,
but...
Dan. I bet you fucking could. But...
I'm chill, though.
That is it for this podcast. Really good stuff. What is your least favorite or favorite video game movie? Please leave a comment below. Make sure you subscribe for more Cinema Royale episodes. Thanks to Daniel for coming on this episode.
Yay!
You can actually check out his stuff. I will leave links to his stuff down below in the description below. And next time, for the rest of us, we'll go into the book-to-film adaptations featuring these guys' bosses... Mr. Code himself. So that should be interesting. That'd be on September 27th.
It's your boy. Your boy is coming.
So thanks for watching and goodbye.
And funny enough, we're also entering James's turf.
Ooh, welcome to my world.
It's scary, scary world.